of them decided to stay. And here we have Esther. The first thing that happens is she loses both of her parents. We have no idea how, but she loses both of her parents. And Mordecai raises her. He's related to her. He's obligated to give
her. Her cousin, actually.
Well, it depends on the... Some translations say cousin, some say uncle.
Okay.
So he's a relative.
Yeah, in the movie, he's portrayed as much older than her.
Yes,
anyway.
Yes, he's her father. He takes over to be her father. And one of the things that I bring out in my my portrayal of her is the fact that he was obligated to give her a home. Mm-hmm. But you can tell by the way he cares for her that he loves her.
Yeah.
Yeah, he loves her as if he is her father. Mm-hmm. And she trusts him.
Yes.
Because he, I believe it was him that said, be a part of this contest for the new king of Persia, or the new queen of Persia. Mm-hmm. Why would you want to be the queen for this king? First of all, the reason he doesn't have a queen is because he wanted his queen to do something that was considered absolutely immoral, stand in front of a group of men so they could ogle her, because the king wanted them to see his beautiful queen. Mm-hmm. And we know that in the Bible it says that she was banished, but we know that she was killed, because that's what would happen, because she said no to the king. How dare she? So now here's Esther, and she's going to go into this harem where every beautiful young virgin in all of Persia has come. Hundreds of women. And the Persian women are beautiful, and they know about beauty. So the chances that she would be chosen to be the queen are practically non-existent.
Right.
And when
they point out, though, that she is beautiful. I mean,
yes, she is a beautiful woman. And perhaps doesn't even know her own beauty.
Until she gets into all the beauty treatments.
Yeah,
and
well, that year in that harem was fun, you know.
Yeah.
Beauty treatments every day.
Like a spa
for
a year.
She was the favorite of the man who was in charge. Mm-hmm. So he gave her private quarters and 7 servants. She did nothing for a year, and every day she could see Mordecai, because he was a minor official, so he could get close enough that they could have conversations. Mm-hmm. So that year wasn't bad. But then you come to the end, and once she spends a night with the king and he sends her on her way, she's now a concubine, and she goes to the harem of the concubines. She doesn't go back to Mordecai. She doesn't marry another person. She's a prisoner, basically. And the king can call upon her if he remembers her. What are the chances? Hundreds of women, hundreds of concubines. Mm. So she, you know, there's an obedience there.
Yeah.
And trust.
Yeah.
Yeah.
So one of the other things I think the most interesting thing to me in the whole, in the book of Esther, is that God's name is never mentioned in the book of Esther.
Yes.
How does that relate to the story?
Well, I think that whoever wrote that book realized that these were Hebrews, so they were God worshipers. Mm-hmm. And you can see God's hand all over it.
Yeah.
You can see it in the faithfulness of Mordecai, mm-hmm. and the trust. You have to trust in something way bigger than yourself, mm-hmm. if you allow yourself to be taken into this harem, knowing that your life could be just nothing but living in a harem for the rest of your life. So there's a trust. And also, when it comes time for her to go to the king without being summoned, and the law said you go to the king without him calling you, your head separated from your body. Now, she doesn't want that to happen. And then the words of Mordecai, who knows but that you have been brought to the palace for such a time as this. What a wonderful thing. And I think that she had to stop and think, okay, I've been raised as a Hebrew. I love my people. If they all die and I sit here and don't even try to save them, what's my life worth anyhow?
Yeah.
And then to trust God. This is the God she was raised. She trusted Mordecai enough to go to that harem. Does she trust God enough to go to the king?
Yeah.
So she calls for a 3-day
fast.
Even
when he doesn't look like he's there.
Absolutely.
And that's why I think his name, I think that God intended, I know that God intended for his name not to be in there, because he breathed those very words.
That's right. That's
I mean,
right.
What a wonderful way to communicate that even when you don't see me, I am there.
I'm there.
All over it.
That's right. Exactly. And he had his hand on her, and she chose to to, she called for a fast, because when the Hebrews want to hear from God, they call for a fast. So yes. That's another clue that God is all over this.
And the sackcloth and ashes as well.
Absolutely, yes. And she fasted not just morning till evening like they usually do, 24 hours a day for 3 days. She fasted, and can you imagine the prayers she said? Mm. Because she already knew the king might, because she is his queen, the king might extend the golden scepter to her and spare her life.
Yes, because at this point she's been chosen and she's
queen
now.
That's right. But what can she say to him that's going to make him care whether the Jews live or die?
Right, except for any possible favor that he might have with her or
right.
God moving in his heart.
Exactly. So, you know, and that's divine. She goes in there and she says, I'd like to fix a banquet for you and Haman. And he, well, of course, wonderful. But then at the end of the banquet, she still won't tell him what she wants.
Oh, and if you guys don't know who Haman is, he's the bad guy in the story.
Oh,
and he's trying to kill
yes.
Mordecai and all the Jews.
Yeah. He doesn't want to just kill Mordecai.
Yeah.
He wants every Jew dead.
Yeah. So not only is Esther like being like totally courageous, she is extremely insightful. She's intuitive.
Right.
She's, well-versed in just personal relations to be able to have the foresight to educate it. Do you just say, hey, let me get Haman in the same room as the king. I'm going to expose
right.
the deceit here.
And then to know that she needs to ask him to come back for another banquet.
Mm-hmm.
Now, the king's not used to waiting. If he wants to know something, he wants to know it now.
Yeah.
But he says, okay, I'll give you another day.
Mm-hmm.
And then the beauty of what God does, Haman decides that he can't go on anymore mm-hmm. with Mordecai alive. And after all, he's a second in command, and he's been to two private banquets, to two private banquets.
Yeah.
He's going to get rid of Mordecai.
He's thinking he's like the top dog.
Oh, yeah. He thinks he's more important than anybody.
Mm-hmm.
So he decides to build a gallows
mm-hmm.
so he can kill Haman in the morning.
Well, let's fast forward a little bit.
Okay.
I don't think we have enough time to talk about all of that. So let's just briefly say, what was Esther's big faithfulness and what we can take away from her story?
Well, we can see that she couldn't see any way that she could survive.
Yeah.
But yet she was willing
yeah.
to do what she needed to do for her people. Again, yeah. selflessness. It wasn't about whether she lived or died.
Right.
It was about her people.
Yeah.
And standing up for them and putting someone else ahead of herself. And she was brought to the palace for such a time as that, because the Jews were all saved.
They were
all saved. And the Jews, right about this time of the year, celebrate the Feast of Purim. And that celebrates when
yeah.
Esther saved the Jews.
Wow, and we can see that even in scary times, I just know this is what we can take from, even in scary times, we stay faithful because God comes through.
Right, and we seek Him.
Yep. And so, you guys, I know you want to hear the rest, so read the book of Esther. And thank you for joining us today. Thank you for joining us.
Mm-hmm.
And remember, you're not alone.